Tonight, Richard drives a pair of wheeled accessories. I discover if the Australians are better at cars than they are at rugby. Hello and welcome. Now, we get a lot of letters of complaint on Top Gear from people with sensible shoes that we only do fast, expensive cars. So, Mr. Hush Puppy and Mr. Brogue, look at this. It's the new Citroën C2. It's a replacement for the little Saxo, and coming up now is my road test of it. It's a little bit shorter than the old Saxo, which makes it easier to deal with in supermarket car parks. And with a split-folding rear tailgate and a practical boot, it's an ideal tool for the weekly shop. Of course, ever since the 2CV, Citroën has been the badge of choice for those of a guardian disposition. So, if you're the sort of person who dines on tofu and plays whale song at dinner parties, you'll love the diesel version, which does 78 miles to the gallon. Old people are going to like the way it's so easy to drive, and the prices too, which start at just £7,500. And this being Citroën already, there's a £500 cashback offer. It's at the track where things start to go wrong. If you buy the hot version, the 1.6 VTR that I have here, you have to have a flappy paddle gearbox, which is horrid.
Into four. And it's not that electric to drive. There's none of the joie de vivre you used to get from old hot Citroëns. It's a bit stodgy.
It's not that fast either. For a car with sporting pretensions, 121 miles an hour is not really enough. So, it's a wonderful car then for everyone except the thrusting young man who wants to get a move on.
No, actually, it's thrusting young men who are going to like this car most of all.
Look at the details. The gear lever that seems to have come from a sex shop. The translucent trim, the 12 million gigawatt stereo. And the bump, which is full of words like wicked and cool.
Now, this, it seems, is the language of something called cruising, which isn't what I thought it was.
Every week in every town in Britain, thousands of young men gather to smoke in a public place. It's a baseline wall of baseball hats and noise. This, it turns out, is cruising.
Oh, look at that one. The Mitsubishi L200 van. This cruising thing, what's it about?
What's it about?
Yeah.
About flexing, man.
It's about what?
Flexing, man. Have a good time and all.
Flexing?
Yeah, yeah.
What are you on about? What is flexing?
Flexing means winding, basically.
It means winding.
I don't know why
you're none the wiser. We're flexing, we're winding.
I've got cameras.
Does anybody here speak English? Does anybody speak English here?
Showing off.
Showing off. This man speaks English. Flexing and winding means showing off. An Astra with a 6 grand stereo in it. Your car's on fire.
Small Citroëns became gods to this lot, street heroes, better even than girls.
There were three reasons for that. One, they were cheap. Two, they were forever being offered with free insurance, which when you're 19 years old is more important than life itself. And three, they were easy to modify.
It all started with the Saxo, which caught Citroën by surprise. They had no idea that this little car would become the darling of the cruise scene.
And I've seen Saxos that have had 40, 50 grand spent on them. I don't know how the Saxo took off as it did. It just kind of exploded. And once a car gets popular, then more and more people are doing more and more stuff for it, so they can get these great bumpers and great suspension kits and engine upgrades. And it's just one of those cars that wears its modifications really nicely. And 9 times out of 10, they look stunning modified, you know.
How much did your Saxo cost?
I spent about £9 buying it and around £12,000 doing it up.
So it's a £21,000 car. That's the
At the moment.
Well, oh, you're going to do more?
Eventually, yeah.
This market is now so vast that when Citroën were designing this thing about 18 months ago, they actually brought one here and said to these guys, is it OK? Do you like it? I bet they never did that when the tree huggers were buying their cars.
Taking all the stuff that we're doing to ours, our older cars, and they're doing it to more production cars, aren't they?
Is that a bad thing?
No.
What it does mean, though, is that the C2's big wheels and wheel arches, its translucent Sexaid gear lever, the trillion-watt stereo, all of it will be ripped out and replaced with the next generation of modifications.
I came with a Citroën C2, and I want to know what you would do to it if you had one.
I would supercharge it.
Supercharge it, turbocharge it, put a V8 in it.
Emerald KG, airport nitro, do the work.
Put the engine in the boot.
Like the four-wheel drive, you know what I mean?
And then make it four-wheel drive. Is this how it starts? Is this how they'll think, well, we've got an idea, let's go and do it?
Yeah. What would you do? What would you do?
And then what, you go and hold up a post office or something?
No!
That makes me feel very sad, that.
Why?
Well, I just wish that we'd had flexing and winding when we were kids, because I love this whole modifying scene. That is brilliant.
Mm. We did have cruising, though.
I know, but that meant going to a gentleman's lavatory, and that's... Anyway, Citroën C2. Things I like about it. It's already available with free insurance. I like the fact it's smaller than the Saxo that it replaces. I love this split-folding rear tailgate like you get on a Range Rover. And already there's a new model called the GT, which has a 1.6-litre engine, and you don't have to have the flappy paddle gearbox with
it. Well, thank God for that.
The only drawback, so far as I can see, is that Citroën never does terribly well in reliability surveys.
No, they don't. And it has to be said that our favourite small car, which is still the Toyota Yaris, that generally does pretty well.
It does, it does. So we would still say that if you are a young man who wants to modify his car, or a Guardian reader, or a normal person, the Yaris is probably still your best bet.
And the Yaris does come with free insurance, and your dealer will tell you that that's only until December the 19th. But don't worry. We know better. That'll be extended.
It will be extended.
News this week. This week, in fact, it has become illegal to use your mobile phone in the car. As we know, you're not allowed
has
to
it?
Hold it. Yes,
oh,
it's
I didn't
fine.
Know that.
You may have heard mention, may have heard mention of this. But apparently, it's not legal to talk on your telephone, but you can still send text messages.
Oh, don't be ridiculous.
I mean, the police can still do you for reckless driving, as always, but under the new laws, texting genuinely isn't covered. If it's on your dashboard in a little holder, you know, the usual things, you can still...
Drive along and text?
Yeah. Oh, my God, I'm going to have a terrible crash. Oh, I have!
There was a marvellous thing. I was listening to Radio 2 this week. No, no reason to mind. Yes, it's a very good radio station. And there was a marvellous letter on it from a guy who said that he thinks this new law is a very good idea because he said he'd seen a woman driving along the middle lane of the motorway on the mobile phone. She'd veered in front of him, causing him to drop his razor into his cornflakes. Which had splashed all over his crossword and ruined his day.
Well, yeah, just,
so I think the mobile phone ban's a very good idea.
They're lethal.
Yeah, they
Send
are lethal.
Text.
Moving on, I'd just like to say at this stage, if I may, that the Ford Fusion, we've been very unkind about it in recent weeks. I think it's a very good car. The Ford C-Max, which is a slightly taller version of the Focus, is a great car.
Really? Jeremy, would this have anything to do with this missive that we received in the Top Gear office recently?
What is that?
It's about the Ford GT. Apparently, 2,150 people have put the name down to buy one of these.
Yeah.
Including you.
Yeah.
But Ford have announced in this that only 101 GTs will now be brought into Europe.
Oh, I didn't know that.
More to the point, they're not going to decide. They're not going to decide who gets one by pulling names out of a hat. Oh no, they're going to decide just to let them go to people they like.
Oh, really?
People who perhaps haven't
said... unaware of that.
People who maybe haven't said nasty things about their car.
Jeremy, I'm wondering if you are the same Jeremy Clarkson who said, I'd rather go to work on my hands and knees than drive there in a Ford Galaxy.
No, yes.
Sounds familiar.
I was young and foolish when I wrote that.
Whoever designed the Ford Galaxy upholstery had a cauliflower fixation.
Yeah, again, I've grown up a lot. I can now see the Galaxy as a
I would rather have a vasectomy than buy a Ford Galaxy.
I repudiate, reject absolutely any suggestion that I'm going to compromise my professionalism and suck up to Ford just so that I can get one of those.
Jeremy
OK, got that clear?
OK, now, do you remember a few weeks back we looked at the VW Touareg, which we didn't like?
Yeah, that's awful.
There is a new version out. It's by some tuners called Abt, who prepare Audi's racing cars. Would you like to have a look at it?
Yes, please.
Here it comes. Is that not the most vulgar and monstrous car you have ever seen?
Oh, I love it! It's
It's fantastic!
No, you don't.
I do.
Look at that front end! It's brilliant.
Glorious! And I'll tell you something else I know about this, Richard, OK? You know it's got the V10 diesel engine in it?
Yes.
They've tuned it up so it now develops more power than a 4.6-litre petrol X5, more than a ML55 Merc, and more than the KNS.
So it's hideous. It's going to go like stink.
It's fantastic.
No, that's it's revolting. It's got big drug dealer wheels.
22 inches of wheels.
Blacked-out windows for pimps.
It's a superb car.
You really like that?
Yes.
You think that's fabulous?
Yes.
You think it's better than a Ford Explorer, for example?
Oh, good point.
No, obviously not. It's not. It's not that good.
Right. I want to talk about insurance companies briefly.
Yeah.
Stay with me, please. That's not the most promising start, I realise. They've started recently using lie detectors, so they use them over the telephone so that when people try and con them out of money, you know, say, tell them lies, they can find out. The latest company to start doing that is Esure, and I can tell them it's a good decision to start using those because another insurance company said since they introduced lie detectors on their telephones, the number of cars, 25%, in fact, 25% of cars reported as stolen have come back. It has come back.
What, is it that car that I reported as stolen last week before you got your lie detectors?
It's come back.
I've just looked in my garage and it's there.
Just while I was chatting, I moved the curtains and there it was all along. It's amazing, isn't it?
Alistair Darling, I'm sure you've read in the papers that he has announced that, yes, there are too many speed cameras in Britain. And what's more, the Department for Transport has said that if we write in complaining about an inappropriately sighted speed camera, they'll do something about it. So, to save you the trouble, we've had a special map made showing where all the inappropriate speed cameras are.
I've got a great letter here that was in one of the newspapers last weekend, and it's from a retired police officer, and he's spent 30 years basically working out what causes car crashes, and he says it's got nothing to do with slight infringements of the speed limit. Causes he'd most readily identify are careless right turn, aggressive high-speed driving, the born-again biker, you two, poor vehicle maintenance, drink driving, and the very elderly.
I'm going to tell
you read that and you think that's the truth.
Somebody talking
sense. It's not people doing 34. My mother has a speeding conviction. She honestly considered suicide. I mean, look, she's 120/12. She's got a speeding conviction for doing 32 miles an hour. Right, that's enough news. What are we doing next?
I'll tell you what we're doing next. Earlier on, we saw Jeremy looking at a street hero car for people who like to flex and wind, whatever that is. But what happens if you're the kind of person who has to have the latest titanium palm top coffee machine? What are you going to go for? You can forget the likes of Ford and Honda. Wrong batch, wrong message. You need something with a bit of style and pizzazz, but nothing that requires effort. So, the Alphas and TVRs are out too. But something has arrived that might just do the job.
And would you look at those? This is the Renault Megane CC, and this is the Peugeot 307 CC. We'll take them both together because they kind of look the same, cost the same, and do the same. And I've brought them for a little drive around London's Docklands, the epitome of modern Britain. Docklands was a wasteland in the middle of nowhere. Now it's got fantastic new developments, but it's still in the middle of nowhere.
The newcomers who live here, they have no heritage, no roots, no mention in the Doomsday Book. They earn money, they see stuff in shops, and they buy it. That's just the way most of us are. Me, I'm partial to a shirt.
So just why are these cars so modern Britain? Well, for one thing, they are achingly fashionable, inside and out, with designer touches everywhere.
Look at that, the brushed aluminium on matte black effect. That's perfection to a bloke, that is. I'd have all my clothes in brushed aluminium and matte black if I could.
In catwalk terms then, bang on. And best of all, you can pose in them all year round.
The folding hardtop used to be the preserve of expensive Mercedes. And then Peugeot introduced it on the little 206 CC. That became the best-selling cabriolet in Great Britain instantly. So it's a fair assumption that these two are going to sell in their billions. But if you're choosing on the roof alone, go for this Renault, because whereas the Peugeot's roof is made of mere tin, on the Renault Megane, it's folding glass.
So you can split them on the roof, but as for everything else, it's Arsenal versus Man United. Both have 2-litre engines with around 140 brake horsepower. Both cost around £18,000. Both have chrome gear knobs.
And with some cars, you see them and say, that's a man's car. Or a girl's car. But these are neither, really. They're kind of in the middle, perhaps verging a little bit on the girly.
So all things to all people for all seasons.
But there's one thing missing. Neither of them is a sports car. So if it's a full-out B-road blaster you're looking for, look elsewhere. All that clever folding roof gubbins has made them heavy. They weigh more than the moon. You can get a 180 brake horsepower version in the Peugeot, but even that takes 10 seconds to hit 60. So wherever you're going, you'll not be going there quickly.
But that's okay, because it's harder to window shop at high speed.
Shops. Lots of shops.
But for all their glamour, I don't like these cars. It's not because they're slow, it's because they are just fashion nonsense, mobile phones on wheels. There's just nothing really there.
They are off-the-peg designer merchandise, bottle glamour, flat-screen tellies. Looks is everything. It doesn't matter how they work. And what they do is give the full, instant consumer hit. You see one of these cars, you want it, then you get it. And for a while, you're glad you've got it. Then in about a year, when you've pressed all the buttons and all the gizmos have gone whir, you'll be bored with it. But it doesn't matter, because by then, something else will come along. And do you know what? It makes me sick just thinking about it.
What makes you sick?
Cars as fashion items. I like Land Rovers, not these. They're just bits of fashion tinsel.
See, the thing is, I've got much better reasons for not liking this Peugeot than the fashionness of it. I mean, the roof, brilliant, no denying that.
Yeah.
Look at the downside, you've got no space in there at all.
No, no.
And it weighs so much. I drove one of these the other day, it's broken.
They both do that. I mean, so as we stand here, both of these cars are slowly sinking into the floor. They're that heavy.
So if I were to say to you, OK, I'm going to shave your poodle...
Right.
Unless you tell me which one you'd have. Which one or the poodle's bald?
Bring on the razor, mate, I'm afraid.
Really? OK, fair enough, there's your answer. Let's meet a guest, shall we? I guess you've all seen the Kumars at 42. Well, now's your chance to see one at 85, because we're going to put him in the Liana. Ladies and gentlemen, Sanjeev Bhaskar!
Now,
first question is an obvious one. When did you get your first Datsun?
Well, I've had two.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thanks for bringing up such a painful memory. Actually, the first Datsun, the second Datsun I had, coincided with the first bit of telly I'd ever done. And I was parked out some studio, still cock-a-hoop about being on TV. And I was just parked on one side, and without any kind of notice whatsoever, a guy just got in and he said, £5, mate, it's just round the corner. And I said, what? And he said, it's £5, mate, just round the corner. And I said, I'm not a cab driver, I'm on television. And he went, who are you?
So where did your car journey begin?
Well, I had a kind of nemesis when I was very young, which was Mr. Hussein's son. And I remember the day the whole car journey started was, I was about 16, 17, I was watching Top Cat, and my dad came in and he kind of switched off the TV and he said, Mr. Hussein's son has just taken the engine out of their Cortina, polished it, taken it apart, polished it and put it back. And I said, yeah, I've just missed the end of Top Cat. And so they suggested, when I said I wanted a car, they suggested that Mr. Hussein's son, who was just phenomenally practical, they said, why don't you go with him to an auction? I said, okay. So we went to this auction, and this green Morris Marina turned up. And the guy
no.
said,
no.
No. No. If it was yours, it was a lovely car. And they said, let's start the bidding at £200. And they got 250, 300, 350. And Mr. Hussein's son said to me, he said, you should get some practice in. So he said, do I hear 350? And I sort of went like that. And he said, do I hear 400? Do I hear 400? I don't want it. And, you know, it's too late. It's kind of, do I hear 400? Going once, twice, three times. To the a scared gentleman in the third row. So I ended up with this green Morris Marina that was just crap.
So what have you got now?
I've got a Peugeot 406. There's a...
No, lots of people have got... Which one?
Coupe. I've got a 2.2 coupe, yeah.
That doesn't strike me as being a particularly Indian choice of car.
You picked your words very carefully there.
Well, I mean, I've been to India.
Yeah, yeah.
And it seems to me that size is what matters there. The larger the car, the kind of better it is, and yet you've gone for something smaller.
Yeah, there's two aspects to that. One is that in India, size doesn't matter. If you need to get 18 people in the car, you can. That's the first thing.
Yeah.
And the second thing about... It's my mate Joe, who kind of deals in Peugeots, who kind of said 406, and I thought, lovely. Now, Indians do like bling. I mean, if there was a Datsun bling...
Hold on a minute. Now, we've had flexing, I've got that, and winding.
Yeah.
What's bling?
Bling is just, you know, flash, colour. It's kind of like... Indian parents, traditional Indian parents, are the only ones who'd watch The Fast and the Furious and say, if you became an accountant, you should get a car like that. Nice blue light underneath. And one when you put the Indian music on, it goes...
Have you actually driven in India?
Only once.
Isn't it just the scariest thing in known universe?
I've done nothing scarier.
I mean, there's a road from Pune to Bombay, which is supposed to be the most dangerous road in the world.
Right.
In the world. I think, and how many people die on the roads in India every day? I think it's 164 people a day.
Yeah.
Well, that's probably just one Datsun.
Yes. That was only the people falling off the roof.
Yes.
The 18 people inside were fine. But it's also, I mean, it's true, it's a high number, but, you know, there's also a billion people.
Yeah.
So it's kind of...
But there's only the same number of cars on the roads there that we have here.
Yeah, but there's a lot more people crossing it.
That's true, and animals. And I also think, actually, that the highway code is at odds with the Hindu code. That sense
yes,
of, no, it'll be all right. No, your brakes have failed, it won't be all right.
Yeah, exactly.
No, no, it will. I've said a prayer to my God. Your brakes don't work! But I said to this guy I was talking to in India, he was saying, well, if it's my day to die, it's my day to die, so I'll go on the wrong side of the road. He goes, yeah, what about the bloke you hit? It's his day to die.
Yeah, exactly.
And the might is right. That's a scary rule.
Yeah, it's kind of... Again, there's two things about the road, the highway code, as opposed to the Hindu code. Well, one is that, yeah, might is right. I mean, if you've got a truck and the other person's got a bicycle, you have right of way.
Yeah.
And the second thing is that it's always the responsibility of the person behind. So nobody goes, he cut me up. Because it's, you should look out for him. So everyone's doing that, so it kind of works in a bizarre way. But the other thing, to tell you the reason that I stopped driving, I did about a mile and I told my cousin to take over. And I said it was at night and nobody uses their headlights, or very few people use their headlights.
True.
Because, you know, you wear them out. You just have to buy another one. And so I stopped when I saw one headlamp coming towards me. And I said, look, I don't know if that's a scooter or it's a truck with one failed headlamp. And my cousin stopped for a second. He said, or two scooters transporting a wardrobe. I said, you know, you're right, there is that third option. I'm an idiot. I don't know why I didn't think of it.
But the great thing is, when things do wear out, the improvisation that you see on the roads in India is just... You see a truck that's hit a tree at a speed you think that was doing Mach 4, and it's not written off.
No, and the thing in India, Paul McGann told me a great story. It's the first time he went to India, and a friend of his had said, when you cross over the border into India, he's in Nepal at the time, he said, you will know, there will be something that will tell you that instant that you're in India. And he crossed over at this truck stop at about 3 o'clock in the morning. He's looking around thinking, well, there's no one here, and it's kind of, my friend said something would happen. And at that moment, they heard a truck coming round the corner with two small boys holding on to the radiator at the front, one pouring water into the top, the other one catching it at the bottom. I'm here.
I genuinely love that.
It's that fatalistic thing. They just won't give up, you know.
Anyway, of course, Liana, how was it out there?
It's just a fantastic and phenomenal mixture of really exciting and incredibly frustrating. It's just, I was so disappointed.
Well, I tell you what, before we see your lap, shall we see some of your practices?
Oh, do we have to?
Well, shall we?
Yes!
Oh, I'm sorry about this, Sanjeev, but the audience has decided.
It's true.
Here we go. Here's the first one. And that's coming into a difficult corner. Oh, a bit of a... Oh, no, he's gone! He's gone! And again. Oh, yes! But wait.
Keep going! That was fantastic.
Nice recovery.
Thank you very much.
I admire your spirit.
Do you know, I halfway through that 360, I thought, I've seen this in Bond films. The thing to do is, if I can put it into gear as I'm turning, wind down the window and take a gun out, this is going to look really good.
Shall we see how you... Well, how would you like to have done, first of all?
Oh, please. It's just so frustrating.
It was wet out there, yeah?
It was, yeah.
How would you like...
And also, it was... There was... somebody had put... I'm sorry.
Here we go.
You should be told the truth about these things. It was wet out there.
Yeah.
There was an albatross that flew in front of the window at one point, which is very rare for this part of England. Mm. Right? And also, there was an ornate tissue box.
We did that in honour of you coming. We put a tissue box on the back seat.
A building tissue box, which weighted the car down.
Who'd like to see his lap, then? Yeah. Here we go. Here we go. There's the tissue box, look. And that's a pathetic start. But, no, that's looking good. Right, coming up to Chicago, tricky corner. Nice, tidy. Very good.
I was pleased.
What was the lip thing there?
Fear.
Tidy again. Very tidy.
I really wish my mum hadn't taught me to drive.
This is a weird tongue thing you've got going in the car. Nicely held on your fast lap here, and coming up to final corner, which is Gamble. Bit of tail out there, and there we go, across the line. So, what do we call it, damp or wet? Wet, yeah, no. Who said damp? It's wet.
You did understand the question. You went on.
I'm calling it a wet lap.
Well, yeah, thank you.
And you did it in 1 minute. Bearing in mind, quick wet laps are 1:54.
Okay.
You did it in 1:51.
Oh.
Yeah, that's you!
Right, we've got a bit of a sort of Street Heroes theme going on this week, and look what I've got.
If I could only have one drink for the rest of my life, it would be a pint of bitter. And if I could only drive one supercar, it would be this. The Aston Martin Vantage. It's superb. In the 1970s, Aston Martin was in trouble. It had turned into a maker of soft GT cars. And then, in 1974, it went bust. Meanwhile, the opposition was on a roll. The Italians were saving weight and putting the engine in the middle. The Germans were still putting it in the back, but with stunning results. Something had to be done. So, Aston's engineers, backed with cash from another optimistic owner, took one of their standard two-door coupes, whipped the engine out, gave it 40% more power, bolted it back in, fiddled with the suspension, and tarted up the bodywork a bit. And then, I like to think, they went to the pub. And they didn't drink, frankly, because what they had produced was, to my mind, the definitive 1970s supercar. In order to understand the impact of the Vantage, I want you to imagine a simple scene down your local boozer. Now, Ferrari, Lamborghini, Maserati, Porsche, all that lot, they're the blokes round the bar with the big opinion, giving it lots of that. Aston Martin is the quiet bloke in the corner, with his pint of best and the crossword. And then, suddenly, he decides he's had enough. So he gets up, he takes them all outside, and he gives them a bloody good hiding. That's exactly what the Vantage did. At its launch in 1977, it was the world's fastest production car, beating the Ferrari Daytona to 60 miles per hour. Only by a tenth of a second, but in a bar brawl down at the Rack and Pinion, that was enough. Aston was back in business and showing how the future of the British supercar would be. Big, front-engined, rear-wheel drive, weighty, well-built, not to be messed with. And it was this approach that would set them apart from the rest of Europe. The Italians, you see, would concentrate on making a really, really fast car, but then they'd start to worry about all the practical stuff, like where's the driver going to sit, and can he see out, and how are you going to join up all those wires that make the lights work? The British way, however, is to start with a normal car and then make it very fast. Think of the Jaguar XJR. It's one of the world's most comfortable saloon cars, and it just happens to go like a stabbed rat. So, this Aston's actually perfectly comfortable. I can get in and out okay, I can see where I'm going, I can see behind me. It's even got quite a decent boot. I mean, it'll still pull my face off if I wanted to, but most of the time it just sort of soothes my fevered brow. And then there's the engine. There's no high-rev melodrama here, just a big, lazy 5.3-litre V8. Say you wanted a bang in a nail. You could belt it really hard with a little hammer, or you could give it a tap with a really big one. The Aston's engine is a sledgehammer. Right, let's meet some more people who might appreciate it. Here we are at the Campaign for Real Ales Festival in Chapel. These chaps can tell you the specific gravity of 300 ales, all in the time it takes me to sink a swift pint. This is where the honesty and goodness of real beer is preserved and honoured.
This is serious business drinking this stuff.
What is a proper pint?
High quality malted barley.
A decent beer is really, you've got the brewer's heart and soul in it, you know.
Traditional ingredients.
It's simple, but it is also complicated as well.
And a careful selection of hops.
What's 501 minus 137?
Why are you trying to trick us?
Yeah, see, they're not real beer drinkers. They don't play. They don't play darts.
So beer isn't complicated. It's just a few simple ingredients all brewed up together. But you can still get it wrong. Get
supercars aren't complicated either. Power, good looks, a great noise. But you could get that wrong as well.
you could end up with a Ferrari Testarossa. Aston Martin, though, got it spot on. I cannot remember ever wanting a car as badly as I want this Aston. It is fantastic. I absolutely love it. And the thing is, so does everyone else. Look, if I were driving a Porsche 911 down this street, some of the villagers would secretly hate me. But everybody loves the Aston. It may be rare and a bit pricey, but somehow, it's of the people. This is the way a British supercar should be. Its values are sound and robust. It's like these magnificent men. They carry a torch for purity, and even though they may drop it occasionally, they are warriors, guardians of a simple faith, their beer. Proper beer, the Aston Martin V8 Vantage. One is simple, straightforward, and for people who don't want anything too fancy. And the other's a pint. Cheers.
Fabulous car, that.
Absolutely brilliant. I'd love one.
In the last 200 years, the only thing the Australians have invented is the rotary washing line. And now, they've made a car! Here it is, a big two-door coupe called the Monaro. On sale in Britain next spring from your Vauxhall dealer, sporting a price tag of £28,000. Being Australian, it's not the most elegant car in the world, and nor is it the most complicated. You get a limited slip differential, rear-wheel drive, and the same 5.7-litre V8 that you get in a Corvette. It's far from the most sophisticated engine in the known universe, but because it's so big, you can put it in six and pootle around at three, doing plenty of miles to the gallon. Or you can poke it with a stick. Then you will go from 0 to 60 in 6.5 seconds and reach a top speed of over 160, usually sideways. Everybody's doing a great dance now. The rotary washing line, and now the rotary car. Now you might think this looks awfully dangerous, but it is Australian, remember, and they like a bit of danger. They've got wild dogs that eat babies for fun. They've got great white sharks. They've got box jellyfish. They've got snakes like crocodiles. And now they've got this, the red-backed, funnel-webbed car. For Europe, they have tweaked the chassis a bit, made it a bit more fun. And you can temper the lively rear end by turning the traction control on. But if you do that, the car sends out some very straight-talking Aussie messages. Let me show you what I mean.
What a poofter.
Backs to the wall, everyone. There's a pom on board. He's turned the traction control on.
What a poofter.
Poofter? You poof. What a poofter. My Sheila could go around the corner faster than this.
This does become wearisome after a while.
You hopeless pom.
Shut up!
And you got lucky in the rugby.
Shut up!
Poofter.
I'm going
poof,
to turn it back.
Poofter.
Off again. There we are. And actually, that's no big problem because, despite appearances, this car really is a big friendly giant. Honestly, I have never driven a car around here that's just so easy at the limit. It's phenomenal. Right, floor. Woo-hoo-hoo! And not just easy at the limit, it's also easy if you go beyond. Into that world of smoke and noise and looking where you're going. Out of the side window. Slow in, brake, and ready. Side window, going down there. It's big and simple, and I love it.
Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come waltzing Matilda with me.
Think of it as a triumph of talk over intelligence. A cut-price BMW M5. A Jaguar XKR that's drunk.
To be honest, the cameraman's not enjoying this very much, but I love it!
It is a hooligan special.
But it's not insensible. The seats are perfect. There's no other word for them. The driving position is spot on. The ride comfort is phenomenal for a car of this type. The space in the back for adults, and with a boot this size, you can even call it practical. Unbelievable. And when you bear the price in mind, it's also very well equipped. I've got cruise control, trip computer, fancy stereo, air conditioning, electric seats. Just about the only thing that's missing is satellite navigation.
But then you don't need it, because like everything Australian, it knows exactly where it's going. Earl's Court.
What a poofter!
Of course, the big problem with this is, if you buy one, five of its mates will turn up with backpacks and want to live in your garage.
Yes. Absolutely, which is going to be annoying.
Because it's got that big Corvette 5.7-litre engine in it, you can tune it up. I mean, you take your wallet in and then you can spend as much as you like. So, obviously, I had to have a go in one of the faster versions.
Imagine a Lotus Carlton and a Calibra Turbo coming together in a broom cupboard somewhere. This is the illegitimate love child that would result. It's got 440 brake horsepower. It does 0 to 60 in 4 seconds or so. It has fully adjustable suspension and it's arrived in Britain spoiling for a freight. So we thought we'd give it one. So, from the country that gave the world the rotary washing line, the Holden Monaro. And from the country that gave the world everything else, including Australia, actually, the supercharged Jaguar XKR. They both cost around £70,000, so this should be close. This should be epic. Hopefully, this should be Johnny Wilkinson and Elton Flatley all over again. The Jag got off to a flying start, but as the race progressed, the Aussie started to close the gap.
Damn! I think I've won.
That is the first time I've ever heard anybody in a racing situation say that. Damn, I think I've won.
Yeah, well, did I win, actually? Can we just have a look at the...
I think you did.
Indeed, look, just by one sort of car's length. But anyway, let's move on from that small and lucky victory they had. Yes. The Cornwall. Where do we think...
Hold on a minute. Jeremy, all the Fords have moved to sub-zero. All of them.
Yeah, it's a fluid thing, the Cornwall. As you know, it's never anything fixed. And I looked at them, they're nice cars.
Really? I tell you what, they're moving back. It's that fluid. That's ridiculous.
Now, look, I want to make it absolutely plain. I'm not doing this. If anybody's watching from, like, Dagenham, I'm not responsible for that, OK? Let's move on. The Holden Monaro. Vauxhall Monaro, as it will be. What do we think?
Cool.
Well, I'm going to canvass the opinion of people who've dressed properly. What do you think?
Excellent. Cool. Makes a nice noise.
Cool car, even though it's Australian. We'll give them a little something.
Yeah, they can't play rugby.
And you?
Coolish.
You think it's coolish? Okay, well, does anyone think it's not cool? Really? Well, let's come and have a word with this chap. Why is it not cool?
It looks like Knight Rider, 45 years on.
Yes, but you see, what I love about this car is it has no styling.
No. There's no pretensions about it.
And you know exactly, you don't have to explain anything with it. So I'm going to put it in the cool section, no doubt about it.
OK, two more cars. These are ones I drove earlier in the programme. These little fashion accessories, the 307cc and the Renault Megane CC.
You're pulling a face. What are you saying?
I've had them both.
You've had them both? No, but you see, you haven't had them both. They're both brand new.
Oh, no. Old ones of them both.
No, there are no old ones.
They've only just done them.
They're new. What, you've had the hatchbacks?
Ever wished you hadn't started something?
You had the convertibles before the metal roofs, the last models of them. And did you like them?
Awful.
Awful.
They were fab.
Fab.
I couldn't get any.
You two know each other?
Yeah. I just follow her.
You thought they were fab, you thought they were awful. We think these new ones are absolutely dreadful. Terrible.
Truly awful, but...
Terrible.
They're cool. No.
They are! Don't come here
this
and argue with us.
This is the way the war... It's not... We're not saying they're good. That's a different thing entirely. They haven't got this yet.
No, they are cool, OK, but we should explain. Because they're kind of French, they're a bit chic. Because they're fashion... In fact, already, can you hold this?
Yeah.
Already, you see, if you bought one then, they were cool, but now they're on the way down.
They're going out of fashion.
They're already. They're moving down again.
Don't this take so long putting them on the board, Jeremy, or they're moving
things
again.
Are going. OK, is that good?
Yeah, that's
good. Anything else we ought to be moving?
If you move a single Ford, yeah. I'll telephone them now and I'll send them copies of everything you've said.